Your Steve Jones Show podcast will start shortly. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Brewers Outlet, your beverage supermarket on Reagan Street in Sunbury.
This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK, sponsored by Brewers Outlet. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Time for Brewers Outlet. You know what? Sit back and enjoy Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. Imports, domestics, microbrews, the best selection of beer anywhere. Wine coolers, water, soft drinks, snacks. They roast their peanuts fresh and out every day. Pickle bar, led by the barrels and the dills. Indeed, second to none. All at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. All right, so we got Brian Tripp coming on the show today. The King is going to be here for the entire show today, except when, obviously, we're talking to Brian. And right out of the gate, America wants to know what your gripe, not rant, but gripe of the day happens to be.
Well, this is actually giving credit where credit's due, and that's to Spencer Strider last night for the way he took the defeat, both of the game and of the series, and actually not blaming it on it being a five-game series like everybody else wants to. Just because the 100-win Dodgers are done, 101 O's are done, and the 104-win Braves are done. It's not because of the five-game series, just because that's the way things go sometimes. And you got to be ready for it. That's the challenge of it. And Spencer Strider said that perfectly, and I want to applaud him for that. And he actually didn't pitch that bad of a game last night, I didn't think.
No, look, he pitched well in game one. He pitched well last night. The reason you lose is quite simple, right? When you hit, when one team hits 11 home runs and the other team scores eight, you're in a pretty good spot.
I think so.
The King is in the building.
King.
Hey, Matt. How are you, buddy?
It's good to hear you in person, sort of, and not on the phone.
Hey, I got a question. A big question. It has nothing to do with sports. You have a program on in the morning at WKOK with Johnny Resnick. Is that the Goo Goo Dolls? Johnny Resnick?
I believe so, yeah. It's just Friday morning. It's just Friday mornings from 9 to 10. Yeah, Legends of Success, yeah.
Yeah, that's Johnny Resnick from the Goo Goo Dolls.
Yep. Fridays 9 to 10.
Oh, man, it doesn't sound like him, but he wasn't singing nothing.
Doing a lot more serious talk. But yeah, yeah, it is a pretty good show, yeah.
Yeah, he had what was it? The perfume place begins with an L.
L'Oreal? I don't know.
Oh, God.
Estee Lauder?
Yes. Had a lot of the woman. So, and her whole story. It was really good. I can't believe it. He's the head goo. Because when we were in New York City for Penn State, and Danny was with me, and we were outside the MTV studio, and Johnny Resnick was upstairs. I said, oh, my gosh, this is a head goo, because I just saw him in concert in Hartford. Like, well, I was still married, so I was divorced at this point. I'm rambling. Okay. I got nothing else.
No. That's perfectly fine.
I think that's the first public comment I've heard about John Resnick on WKOK, so I like it. Okay. We'll take it.
So,
hey, okay. He's good. That show's good.
Well, so there, I don't even know which year this was, but I brought the kids to the NIT. Because, look, we've been there six times. So it's like after a while, they kind of run together. And I get tickets for him to go. So the kids are sitting with him at Madison Square Garden. Well, I have to do the post-game show. Go ahead. Tell them about your trip back. to the hotel, to the Marriott Marquis.
Well, you see, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Oh, my keeps. Anyway, this is really. Have you ever been here, Matt? It's so cool.
I have. Yes, I did a show in there the day that Oklahoma and Texas were joining the SEC.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So we can walk from Madison Square Garden back to the hotel. And so I had the kids. He said, "Will you bring the kids back?" I said, "Sure." So we walked back, and I had Danny. Was Michael there?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Michael's there.
And Christopher.
Yep.
Okay. So I had to get them something to eat. So I went to one of those newsstands there that they have, you know, candy. And I bought them all kinds of candy bars and stuff, and that was supper. Well, while I'm doing that, this guy's behind me, and he sees what's in my wallet. So I take a couple steps back, and now I'm giving their kids their Snickers bars and M&Ms and all this stuff, and they're happy, and that's a good dinner. And so
the lingerie on the deck, all the janitor.
So the guy puts his hand on my shoulder and says, "You got $5 for a beer." And I'm like, I'm A, not afraid of you, B, leave us alone. And that all I thought was, I got these three kids with me, and if they weren't with me, I'd knock them out. But they're with me, and I'm not doing anything. I give them the $5. So everybody's like, how could you just give the guy the $5? That's, I don't know if he has a gun. This is New York City. We are tourists written all over us, you know? And so I gave him the money, and to this day, he thinks I'm a fool for giving the guy money.
Who, me?
Yeah.
Well, you have to perfect in New York the...
I'm not
stare down at the pavement.
Honest to God, I was protecting your boys.
Oh no, I totally understand that. I'm saying, when you walk in New York City, you look straight down.
Yeah.
No eye contact.
No, you don't. I gave a guy asked me a couple weeks ago, for $20 for a beer. He asked me for money for a beer, and I gave him $20. You know why? Because he didn't lie to me. He didn't. He was a panner, and I was really ticked off. I mean, I had a doctor's appointment. I had my hip replaced like 4 years ago, and this appointment was made 2 years ago, and it was just a follow-up. I'm driving to the hospital, and the road to the hospital is gone. There's like they're doing construction on it, so this is Hartford, Connecticut, and they detour. If you do a detour in Hartford, Connecticut, near St. Francis Hospital, you better have a gun because it's a really bad place. So I said, fine. I made it around the detour. I can get to the parking garage. I get to the parking garage, it's gone. It was like demolished. I'm like, holy crap. So where do I park? So I drive around the place, and they say, here's a little parking place that you can park in over here. So I park, and it's right near the opening of the building. I go in the building. I look at, there's my surgeon's name, third floor, same place. I go to the third floor. I get out of the elevator. There's my doctor's name with about 100 others. I turn a right and go down the hallway. It's all dark. That doctor's gone, too. So, like, the road's gone. The parking garage is gone. The doctor's gone. And I am not happy.
I'm just glad you got that procedure done before all this happened.
Yeah. At least I could get home. But I was... So, I go to leave, and I'm like, you know, you're thinking the money they make and all this. And I saw this guy is waiting. I called the doctor, and they said, oh, we moved 2 years ago, but sorry, we didn't tell you. She goes, well, why don't you head over here now? We're in Farmington. I said, I don't even know how to get out of the parking lot. Never mind get to Farmington. I said, I'm going home, back to work, and we'll regroup. So, and when I'm leaving, this guy is just, and he had to be like 75 years old. And I said, you know what? Stop feeling sorry for yourself. Look at this guy. You know, he asked me for money for a beer. I said, how's $20? And he says, oh, my God. That was like, you know, the heavens opened for the guy. So, that's okay. That's all I got.
By the way, the John Resnick is not what you, who you're thinking of. It is somebody else. Boss Man just let me know on that one.
Oh, really?
So, this is a different one.
Wow.
So, there you go.
That burst my bubble.
Just had to correct that.
Yeah.
So he gives $20 over here. The soup barely pulls, and he's up $20 at Chick-fil-A. Well, how are you doing? I can't.
Does Kevin do the lead-ins? This is WKOK?
No, it's somebody different.
Oh, I thought it was him, too. Wow. Was I even on WKOK?
Yeah, you were.
You can hear that station for a long way.
Yeah, we're a 60,000 watt station. Yeah.
60?
I believe this is 60,000 watt. I know our sister station 94KX is, and I think this is similar power over here on KO. You can hear us as far east as like Hazleton-ish area, maybe even up like a little bit toward northeast PA, and you can hear us as far west as State College.
Yeah, I drove
during the day at least.
Yeah, right after I got off at 81, I put it on, and I got it a little fuzzy, and then it was really clear for about 60, at least 60 miles, 70 miles. So I was like, wow, good station. So.
All right, my turn to talk. Let's take a break. We'll come back with more in a moment. Brought to you by Brewers Outlet on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Oh, my almighty!
Want to work for a stable yet growing company? Got it. Want to work for a family-owned business with over 100 years experience in taking care of customers and employees? Got it. Want to work for a leader in selling more cars and satisfying more customers? Got it. Who has all that? SMC Sunbury Motor Company is looking for technicians across all their departments. Whether you're an entry-level technician, an experienced technician, or someone looking for a career change, Sunbury Motors would love to hear from you. They're looking for technicians for their quick lane, car and light truck service, heavy truck service, body shop, and frame and alignment division. You can apply online at sunburymotors.com, in person at our North 4th Street location, or call Todd at 570-286-7746. Your new career of working on Fords, Kias, Hyundais, Western Star trucks, plus anything that fits in the door,
and some things that don't.
Join Sunbury Motors. Your new career is waiting for you.
All right. I watched a good portion of the Phillies-Braves game last night, but I did switch over in the fourth quarter and watch West Virginia and Houston. And it was a wild game between the two. And there are teaching moments that happen in games that coaches, if they're doing their job right, then show clips to their teams. West Virginia-Houston provided a boatload of them. So West Virginia's down, driving. Then they get to a fourth down and 10 at midfield. Garrett Green throws a pass over the middle on a slant that gets about 25 yards, and he keeps going, and gets into the end zone and scores. And with 12 seconds to go, West Virginia takes the lead. They're like, oh, my goodness, they're going to be 5-1. But on the play, Garrett Green, the quarterback, was called for an unsportsmanlike celebration penalty.
Oh.
All right? Okay? This is like when the suit makes a sale. No, that was
S-U-I-T. That spells suit.
It's like, you know, I mean, Kevin, you do know that, like that's your job, right? You're supposed to do a whole bunch of these, not just one. So he gets called for a 15-yard celebration penalty. So instead of kicking off from the 35, they kick off from the 20, which means the possibility of belting it through the end zone and getting a touchback and starting at the 25 is off the boards. Instead, they kick it. He runs it back to the 45. Right, which it wasn't a long return. He returned to 20 yards. okay? 23, 24 yards. They threw one quick out of bounds, got it to the 49-yard line of West Virginia. Then he heaved it up, and here's lesson number two. What are you taught to do as a defensive back when the ball is thrown to the end zone?
Knock it away.
You knock it down, not away, down. Well, they knocked it in the air, and he caught it for a touchdown in Houston 1. I go back to 1982. Penn State is playing Nebraska, one of the greatest games, one of the five greatest games ever played in Beaver Stadium. Two great teams. Penn State won the national championship that year. Penn State won it 27-24 and won it with 2 seconds to go on a touchdown pass from Todd Blackledge to Kirk Bowman. The only two catches Kirk ever made in his career were in that game, and they were both touchdowns. His son Allen is the quarterback right now. You saw him play at Texas Tech, Michigan, right? The key to that final drive, and I know everybody talked about whether McCloskey was in bounds or not when he caught the ball. The key to the whole drive was on the kickoff. Turner Gill
scored. The only one who would ever remember all this stuff is you.
Well, Turner Gill scored on a touchdown run by the goal line. Nebraska kicked off. There was a minute 17 to go. And on the kickoff, got called for a personal foul. And instead of Penn State starting at the 20, because back then you started the 20 on a touchback, not the 25, Penn State started from the 35. That extra 15 yards made a difference. And that same thing happened last night for Houston. That unsportsmanlike conduct celebration penalty gave them the opportunity to at least run two plays and then throw the Hail Mary at the end.
That's exciting. But, yeah. You know, and driving up, I was thinking about this, and they played last night, and somebody who was really good at it was obviously Aaron Rodgers and Russell Wilson.
Yeah.
What has happened to Russell Wilson?
Didn't the Eagles try to trade for your team?
They did, and they somehow dodged the bullet.
This goes back to what I was talking about the other day. In fact, we were talking about it yesterday because the game was last night. You have to understand it's very difficult to do. The Patriots, during their glory years, were great at this, understanding the shelf life of their players. Like, you are at the end. Seattle obviously figured out he was at the end, and they fleeced Denver in that trade. They figured it out. It's like, is something not quite right?
He threw for 98 yards last night.
In fact, I watched the last minute and a half of the first half, and they showed the stats. He was 7 of 11 for 38 yards.
Yeah.
Like, you have to be kidding me.
I was in two Super Bowls.
Yeah.
And won one.
Yeah. Russell Wilson's stats brought to you by Cumberland Farms. He's 7-11. No, that's not good. All right. Brian Tripp in the next half hour. He'll be the sideline reporter standing in the rain. Somebody has to do it.
I'll do it.
I'll never forget him in Michigan State a couple of years ago in the snow.
Oh, standing next to the heater. I said, you know, Brian, I said, that is for the players. You do know that, right? We'll talk to Tripper next half hour.
This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK, sponsored by Brewers Outlet. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, almost Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. And today's show brought to you by Brewers Outlet. Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. Imports, domestics, microbrews, the best selection of beer anywhere. Wine coolers, water, soft drinks, snacks. They roast their peanuts fresh and out every day. Six great flavors of slushies. And the pickle bar, led by the barrels and the dills, indeed second to none. Stock up for a big week of the National League Championship Series as your Phillies take on the Arizona Diamondbacks. All right. Well, let's bring in a Phillies fan. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, Brian Tripp now joins us, who will be getting himself mentally ready for the Phillies' big NLCS appearance. Welcome.
Steve, great to be with you. It was a great, great game last night. What a series. And Citizens Bank Park proves to be the toughest environment in pro sports right now.
Yep. I mean, they're fun. I mean, let's say the fans are fun. When they're doing the mock chop, that was a riot. Okay. We'll get to hockey in a moment. So as you have observed from the sideline and so forth, what has been your impression watching this team? Because to me, the question is always, when you get to this point, are you a better team now than you were a month ago? Are they?
Yeah, I think they definitely are. And I think the entire team resembles the head coach. And James Franklin is so consistent in everything that he does. Mm-hmm. I think the team has been really consistent in everything that they do. Their approach, no matter the situation, and for much of the year, as we know, they've been playing with a lead and playing fairly comfortably. But to go on the road at Northwestern and to trail in that game, road game in the Big Ten, another 11 a.m. Central kick, I didn't notice anything change in that situation. And to do that with a quarterback who's making his sixth career start, right, coming up on Saturday against UMass, mm-hmm. they've just been so even keel, I think, the whole season to this point. And that's what's really impressed me about the way that they've handled their business so far, just how much that demeanor hasn't changed, particularly when you look, and we talked about it coming into the year, Steve, with the leadership that Sean Clifford, that Juice Scruggs, that P.J. Mustafa, that Jair Brown provided last mm-hmm. year. The question was, where do those voices come from this year? And I think it's been leadership by committee and just a team that is so hungry, so focused, so bought into that 1-0 approach that then has, in turn, translated over to the football field. And that's why you're seeing the complimentary football, really very, very few mistakes made. And when something hasn't gone their way, the few times it hasn't, they're just on to the next play and they handle their business.
I feel maybe one of the more telling comments of the season was your halftime interview with James. Mm-hmm. Penn State had just scored to make it 10-10, so it's tied at the break. And when he looked at you and said, "We're in a good place," I felt that was as telling a comment as I've heard a head coach give.
Yeah, I think that was a pure confidence in, number one, the talent they have in the room, but number two, the maturity that they have in that room. And again, I think you've noticed it with him throughout the course of the season. I think his demeanor hasn't changed. You could tell coming into the year that there was a confidence in this group and the way that they can win. And I think by saying the way that they can win, it's just so many different ways. If they need to lean on the defense to make a big play, you know the defense is going to make a big play. If you know the offense is going to put the defense in a great spot because they're not turning the ball over and you start to win the time of possession, you win the field position battle. All those things add up. And I think he has such a confidence right now in the group and their maturity and how they're handling every situation. I agree. I thought that comment was really telling, especially in that situation on the road. Granted, we all know Penn State's a better football team than Northwestern, but it's a situation they hadn't been in. And to hear the head coach so calm and so poised and so composed in that moment, I think that translates right over to why and how they're playing.
Interesting tomorrow, because we're talking about wet weather. And something that becomes precarious in wet weather is the players really rely on gloves, mm-hmm. right? Across the board, gloves. And if anybody has ever, like, if you ever shake the hand of a football player that's wearing gloves, like, you got to pull your hand out of there because you kind of ask yourself how they ever drop a ball.
Yeah.
Well, wet weather makes them slick. Nike has come up with a glove. And this is something, for example, Chris Godwin playing down in the humidity of Tampa, right, sweats a lot. They've come up with a glove that reacts to rain and creates stickiness. I find all the, and Penn State has them. They're going to use them. I find this amazing.
And that's what I'll be watching when we're out there during pregame. Of course, he had to bring up the rain now. I was trying to avoid it until tomorrow, since it is an absolutely picture-perfect
today
day
is gorgeous.
For homecoming and the parade.
Today is gorgeous.
Today is gorgeous. But it's not just the gloves. It's who ends up wearing the gloves. And we've even seen in the past, you know, players like the quarterback, the running backs, who maybe don't wear those gloves, who's going to turn to them in that rain situation. So that will be what I'm watching tomorrow on the sideline when the game starts. Who is wearing those gloves because of exactly what you're talking about, the way that they are manufactured now for the rain to actually help you in those situations.
They could play with
not to mention it's going to be like 45 degree real field, and that changes things too a little bit.
Yeah. And they practice with them this week. I mean, they use them this week, which I found to be interesting. But, man, when they got up and talked about that, I was like, oh, you got to be kidding me, really? Right? And I told Jack about that because Jack talks about the glove thing all the time. So far, men's hockey, Clarkson, St. Lawrence, it's only the beginning. What do you think of the beginning?
Well, I thought to go on the road at LIU in the first week and to come from behind and win it 3-2. And look, they went into that rank, the team that's supposed to win. And I'm not going to say either team, and you would expect this in the first game of the season, played their best hockey. But LIU was about a full year older in average age.
Right.
And instead of looking at classes, junior, senior, whatever, in hockey, just because there's so much difference, I look at what's the average age of the team. And they were nearly 23 years old.
Yeah.
They were about 8 pounds heavier than Penn State and about an inch bigger than Penn State. And they played a really physical game to start. And Penn State came out a little bit slow. But I thought they weathered that. And that was, you know, their Stanley Cup, sold-out building, 2,000 people, dimly lit practice facility. It wasn't playing in Pagoule. It wasn't playing in a Big Ten building. And I thought
Was this the Islanders?
Was this the Islanders
practice facility? Yeah.
Yep.
And that's the one. One out by Uniondale. That's not the one in Elmont.
It was right across from the old college.
Yeah, exactly. It's in Uniondale. Yep.
And you know, Steve, like, they never played a perfect game, but to overcome that physicality with how much scoring they lost from last year, losing their top four point producers, top five goal scorers, to get a big power play goal late, special teams struggled last year, to get a big penalty kill late, and really for the last 30 minutes of the game, LIU had no sustained puck possession in the Penn State zone. I thought it was like a real good, gritty, gutty character win. A couple of different areas where you may have gone in with question marks or a little bit of unknown, they answered some of that with who scored and stepping up. I thought for the first game of the year, like, yeah, you want to win every game 5-2, 6-2, 7-2.
Sure. Right.
What a good way to start. Like, a really, really good way to start, even though they didn't play their best hockey.
As you mentioned, special teams were not their strength last year. Yet in this opener, and it's only a game, but they were 3-for-3 in the penalty kill. They were 1-for-4 in the power play, and the one turned out to be the eventual game-winning goal. I mean, that's the kind of progress I think any coach is looking for after an offseason.
Yeah, and going into the season, Connor McEachran, Connor McMenamin, Kevin Wall, Paul DeNaples, guys that had been stalwarts and played so many minutes in big situations the last few years, you don't have them anymore. So it's not just incoming freshmen, but it is a Dylan Lucas who only played in 8 games last year after just emerging on the scene after coming in halfway through his freshman season from the NCDC. Who is this guy? And he scored in almost every playoff game that year. He's now in a bigger role on the power play.
Okay.
Tanner Palacek, who comes in from Dartmouth, a transfer defenseman, quarterbacking the power play unit. And you're just kind of wondering, how are people going to handle these different roles that they're put in? And they were responsible for Palacek with a big shot that was tipped in, Lucas with a tip-in for the game-winning goal. They're responsible for 2 of the 3 goals in the game. I think to see players that you need to count on to step up in those spots to get that, granted just 1 game, you have to be really encouraged about the start.
Yeah, because for Lucas, that's the first goal he scored since 2022. So that had to be a great emotional boost for him.
Yeah, it definitely was for him. I think, you know, Carson Dick made some really good plays. He didn't play a ton last year, but he's one of those guys, character guy. Guy loves him. The team loves him. and you can tell that he's going to have a bigger role this year. I thought he played really well. Then the freshman, I thought Matt DeMarsico, who scored the first goal in the game, he's got great hands. He was the leading scorer with Green Bay in the USHL last year. So he has a knack for scoring. I thought he skated really well to go along with his hands. The Aiden Fink was involved in a goal-scoring play. He comes in as the Canadian Junior Hockey Player of the Year last year, was originally committed to Wisconsin. He's involved in a big goal. And then to see the development, the freshman defenseman from a year ago, Carter Shade, Jared Crespo, and Dylan Grattan, I think that decor is really a strength of the team this year. And you can just see the steps that they made from year one to year two. And when we say, you know, Guy and I talked about this pregame, we talked about it postgame, when you say the decor is the strength of the team, so many people think, oh, okay, so they're going to try to win 1-0, 2-1 sure. games. Well, the way they want to play, it's nice to have a great back end, but it's more – it's not blocking shots and fogging up your own zone and being on defense the whole game. It's the second that puck comes in the zone, moving it right back out of the zone as fast as possible. So that way you're sustaining the pressure in the puck at the other end. And that way the decor is driving what ends up being a really good offense that becomes your best defense.
And they'll, as I mentioned, they've got Clarkson, St. Lawrence. Then they finally come home and they've got AIC to finally play the home opener.
And the Clarkson-St. Lawrence trip's a tough trip.
Sure.
Up there, there's two physical teams. Clarkson's a really good team, you know, either an NCAA tournament team or close to it. Every year, it's a bus ride. You're switching rinks between Friday and Saturday night. You know, there's not a whole lot going on in Potsdam, New York. And then all of a sudden, you walk in, and it's an intimidating, sold-out venue. And they're a busy, physical, heavy, puck possession-type team. Play kind of similar to Notre Dame may play if you start to look at Big Ten teams comp. Clarkson's the better of the two, actually split with Notre Dame last weekend. But that's a real tough trip, too, to go up there. And you'll learn a lot about the type of team that you have. But they don't mind, Steve, honestly, playing away to start the year with so many new faces and just a different group, being able to get the guys together on the road. They felt like, you know, and also not playing in Missoula, there's a little pressure when you're playing at home, I think, with that crowd. Kind of like ease into this thing, get the group together, really good bonding experience.
No,
start.
Actually going on the road does that. That you know, you bond going on the road. So tomorrow, just some general thoughts. And, you know, people always ask what effect the weather could have on it. What's your thought on that?
Yeah, I think you obviously are concerned about the effect that the rain could have on the game, but particularly when you think of rain, think of field, and think of injuries and anything like that. And
you think about Northwestern last year. I mean, that you know, we thought that would be an easy game and end up being 17-7.
Yeah, turnovers, sloppy field, weather, a great equalizer. You know, I was looking, it looks like a little wind, but not crazy with wind tomorrow. I know we talked about that and how difficult that can be, but they've already played in a rain game this year. As you know, they've practiced in the rain a billion times throughout the course of the year.
I've stood there.
Stood there in it way too often. But I think you just want to see them come out and play the consistent complementary football that they've played all season to this point. UMass obviously defensively has allowed a lot of big plays. You do want to see the ability to create those explosive plays against that defense. How does the rain impact the ability to create those explosive plays? I don't know. But I think those are a few things that you kind of look for in a game like this.
My friend, we will see you tomorrow. Probably the driest you'll be is in the pregame show.
I agree with that. but I'm looking forward to it no matter what.
Yep. All right, here we go. It's second half. It gets rolling. I mean, I know it's 5-7, 7 to go in the regular season, but, you know, let's face it, after the bye week,
it feels like it now.
Yep.
Yeah, feels like it now.
Thanks, Brian.
Right.
See you tomorrow,
thanks,
buddy.
Steve. Yep, see you.
All right, Brian Tripp, play-by-play voice of Penn State men's ice hockey, Penn State baseball, and our sideline reporter for Penn State football. I know Doug in Wellsboro called. We're more than happy to take Doug's call because I think he wanted to talk to the king.
Let me see if we have him. Doug, you there?
I'm here.
Doug. How are you, Doug?
Is the king there?
Yeah, sitting right here.
Hi, Doug.
King, I've been talking to Steve for 25 years now. And I just want to let you know that your segment and Matt's rants are the best part of this show.
Thank you. It's fun.
You, sir,
I'm a welder. I'm not a radio
hero.
No, we have to make sure we listen to you every Friday or every Thursday afternoon or every Friday afternoon to get your segment in because we really enjoy it.
Oh, I'm glad you do. It's fun. It's fun. It's fun to be able to talk with my brother every week. Yeah. So, because we're kind of far away, so I was able to make the trip to get out here today. So,
I just have a couple quick questions for you. Number one, where does Steve have his Enfield Hall of Fame trophy in the house? Is it somewhere prominent that everybody sees it?
Well, I just delivered it today. So there's one here and there's one at Enfield High School in Enfield. So he doesn't have it hanging yet because I just brought it in about an hour ago. So
where do you think he'll put it? Like somewhere like right at the front doorstep or something so everybody sees it?
He was eyeballing the column outside with a spotlight. Or maybe on the bumper of his car.
That's something the suit would do, I think.
The second one is
pictures of him and hang it everywhere.
The second one is when Steve was little, what was the most trouble he ever got into as a kid?
Oh, I've been asked this question before.
Yeah.
Steve was a really, really good guy.
Make something up then.
Well, I can give you a really good one.
I think I know which one he's going to tell.
Cause he's got his head buried right now.
Today would have been my dad's 91st
that's
birthday.
That's right. Today's October 13th. Okay. So
it was the day that I yelled at you about the car and dad got mad. Yeah.
Well, yeah, but that's he said a really bad word. And my father was 6'1", about 300 pounds. And he was sleeping. And I took the car out the night before. And I'd like to indulge a little bit more than Steve. And so Steve knew. And I got home and didn't think anything of it. So he goes to pick up his bride-to-be to bring her to church. They go to the 11:30 mass. Mm-hmm. And he gets about a quarter mile down the road and he runs out of gas. So, and I don't really remember if I knew if I had gas or not. But anyway, he comes home and drops the bomb on me. And how could I be so stupid or whatever? But anyway, he drops the bomb and my father just absolutely, we hear bang, bang, bang. He was in bed. Yeah. He gets up. Don't you ever say that word in my house. Get a bleeping gas can and go get gas. It gets better because they leave to go get gas and it's pouring rain.
Yep.
It is pouring rain. And me and my mother are standing in the living room, and I'm like, wow, Dad's really pissed, you know? So, so I said, oh, my God. I look out the front window, and my father is walking down the street, and Steve is driving in the car behind him, and it's pouring rain, and Steve doesn't dare pass him. That was probably his worst moment. My father went back to bed. Yeah. So,
cool.
It wasn't enjoyable.
Oh, you didn't want to. Hey, I worked with my father. I mean, you didn't want to make him mad. I mean, the guy who I was supposed to come with me this weekend was Connecticut State wrestling champion and a monster of a human being, and he worked at the shop. And he said, that's the one guy I would never, ever dream of messing with. He was a big... remember when you said, my brother and my father are here. I think they're hugging in the end zone. Nah, wasn't a lot of hugs.
No.
I just wanted to call in, though. We really get a kick out of all your stories, especially about your mom and stuff and all that stuff over the times you've been on and stuff. So we really like to listen to you guys. So
thanks, Doug. That's really nice to say. I appreciate that.
Thank you very much for that. We appreciate it. Bob, remember, Mom, it's your when they dedicated the building. She I had to drop her off at the building, and the Penn State Nittany Lion came out and got her. Yeah. And she was like a little kid. She's all curled up next to him.
There's a picture here in the office that you can't see, obviously, because we're on radio. But that's me with the Nittany Lion. You know what I'm doing there? That's me thanking him for how he took care of mom.
Yeah,
that's why that picture's up.
She was so happy that day. But she was a tough nut, man. She worked in a prison.
Yeah.
Nobody messed with her. She was 4'11".
Yeah. I can tell you two people didn't mess with her. All right, so we'll come back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Party time, game time, or just fun time. Doesn't matter what time it is, because it's Brewers Outlet time. The Beverage Supermarket has the area's largest beer selection. Imports, microbrews, ciders, and domestics. Pick from over 100 ice-cold 12-packs and dozens of 24-ounce singles. Soda, snacks, hot sauces, fresh roasted peanuts. Make it one-stop party shopping, and don't forget the pickle bar. So whatever you're celebrating or just doing it up, Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street, Sunbury, wants to see you. And thank you for your years of patronage.